to Calixto Granados and Enriqueta Elvira Campiña. So later, the whole family relocated to Barcelona in 1872, which is where he spent probably the most, like the biggest chunk of his life and where he developed his career as a solo pianist as well as a composer. And his first kind of introduction to somewhat formal musical lessons were from a man named Jose Junquera, who was an elderly Castilian soldier who lived around his hometown, and he was also a flautist. Apparently, well, Granados talked about how he had a bunch of missing teeth, which like affected the way that he played the flute, so I thought that was funny. So later he got some lessons from Francisco Xavier Hornet, and those were like the first piano lessons that he took, starting when he was 13, from the years 1878 to 1882. Later, Granados began classes with a man named Joan Baptista Pujol for a number of years, and he had his own music academy. So a little bit about Pujol. He was the author of a very influential treatise on piano playing, and Pujol also had a direct connection to the tradition of Franz Liszt, since he was a student of Pere Pintorer, who was a Catalan pianist, and he also studied with Liszt in Paris. So Pujol was kind of Liszt's like musical grandson. And Pujol himself went to Paris to finish his training with Henri Rebert at the Conservatoire in Paris. So later he returned to Barcelona and he started a Catalan school of piano virtuosity that created a huge impact to the piano world, but also to the Spanish musical tradition in general. And Pujol taught and trained many of the pianist composers of this time in Spain, which included Joaquín Malats, who was a piano virtuoso. You may think his name is familiar because Isaac Albéniz dedicated his giant piano work Iberia to him, and then Malats also premiered Iberia. There's also Ricard Viñes, who also premiered a number of works by Ravel, Debussy, Satie, Falla, and Albéniz. And he was also the piano teacher of Francis Poulenc, as well as Carles Videla, who was also a prolific piano performer in Spain at this time. So Granados and his mother initially went to him to ask for lessons, but Pujol said that he had too many students, but Enriqueta, his mother, persisted, and she just insisted and asked Pujol to just listen to young Granados play the piano, which he finally caved and started listening to him play. And Granados played Gottschalk's The Last Hope for him. And from that moment on, Granados noted that Pujol turned into a completely different person. Like, he immediately warmed up to him just because he was so impressed by his playing, like, immediately. So after a short period of study, Pujol felt that Granados' protege was ready for a competition, and he had him perform Schumann's Sonata in G minor during a contest that was named after Pujol himself. And then they had also had Granados play a very difficult technical passage by sight. And the jury for this competition included Martínez Humbert, Pedrell, and Isaac Albéniz, who was also living in Barcelona at this time. And they all judged Granados the winner of the concert, of the competition, which was very impressive because it was like the first competition he ever did and he didn't have much formal training at this point yet. And about Pujol's piano school, like philosophy of teaching, it was primarily focused on the attention to clarity of voicing, tone color, and very specifically the mastery of pedaling. And as I said a little earlier, Granados hadn't been studying for a very long time, and he was considered somewhat of a late bloomer because he was really beginning on the piano around his teenage years. And if you compare him to one of his contemporaries, Albéniz, he had his debut performance on the piano when he was only 4 years old, so in comparison to that, he's way behind. But Granados showed really amazing talent early on, and he quickly made up for any lost time. So unfortunately, Granados' dad passed away very suddenly and unexpectedly when he was only 57 years old, and this left Enriqueta, his mother, with very little resources to support her family. And although Enriqueta did receive her late husband's military pension, it was just barely enough to support the whole family. She had 6 children, including Granados, so this was a big family and it was hard to support them. So Enrique, to help out, he tried to see like what skills he could use to make some money for the family, and this was mostly performing and playing the piano. So Granados begins to gig in very informal settings, so mostly cafes in Spain. And about cafes and cafe culture in Spain, these were like a totally new concept. Cafes began to spring up in Madrid and Barcelona around this time, and they became a very big and essential part of Spanish culture during the 19th century. And at this time, cafes were considered these important locales where people would come and exchange ideas, discuss the latest trends in politics and the arts, which sounds very familiar to us. Like, all of us are always in Fountain City or Iron Bank, like, either gossiping or talking about the arts and stuff. And this is where Granados got his start as a professional musician, which was mostly through the help of Vidiela, who was a studio mate. He was one of the pianists that also studied with Puyol. And Vidiela had worked there before him, so he kind of inherited the job from him. So the first place that he was gigging was in the Café de las Delicias, which was on the Ramblas in Barcelona, and it was next to the Teatro Principal. And this place featured music along with coffee, drinks, and food, and it was adjacent to an opera house like many other cafes at this time. So unfortunately, Granados got fired from this gig because the owner of this cafe really loved opera excerpts, and it really was not of interest to Granados, which I think kind of speaks to his personality. He was known as this romantic, like, in essence, because even though he was like doing these gigs to support his family and to try to help his family, he was still like picky about it. He didn't care that he was getting paid because he wanted to play the music that he really liked to play, which was mostly like European romantic music, not necessarily opera. So through his sister, Granados became acquainted with Eduardo Conde, who was a wealthy merchant in Barcelona, and he was also the owner of this big department store there. And Conde was a lover of music and the arts, and he took a special interest in Granados after hearing the young man play. And Granados said about Conde that from that time forward, he became kind of his protector, and that he owed him like everything he became eventually. And Conde eventually employed Granados to teach his own children the piano, and he actually matched his former salary at the cafe. So he was doing a lot less work and getting paid the same amount, and he was doing something that he enjoyed more than like playing opera excerpts. So later, he started a job at a different locale named El Filipino. But this venue had its own set of challenges because he was expected to accompany musically inspired customers who might feel the need to burst out into song or play an instrument. He was just expected to be like on call, ready to accompany anyone, just ready at all times, which he also did not like, and he eventually left that job as well. So Granados had his first official debut performance on 1886 when he was just 18 years old, and this was at the Ateneo Barcelonés. And this program was a type of like studio recital which included the students of Puyol, and they had them perform some solo works as well as some chamber works, and Granados performed some works with his studio mate Francisco Viñas. And overall, Granados didn't really receive a very extensive formal education, you know, in terms of music and otherwise. Although he was still very refined, he spoke a few different languages, which included Castilian, Catalan, and French. And he was very well-read, and through his initial private instruction, he was able to obtain a good and solid understanding and appreciation of music history and theory. But he eventually left Spanish to go study in Paris. So he moves to Paris with the help of Conde, the wealthy businessman, and his biggest aspiration there was to study with Charles Serveriot in the conservatoire. But unfortunately, Granados got a case of typhus in 1887, and by the time that he finally recovered, the entrance exams for the conservatory were over, and he was also 20, which meant that he was ineligible to apply to the conservatory. That was really sad. But he still became Berriot's private student, which was like his biggest goal, was to study with him there. And his former studio mate Viñas was also there, and they were roommates. They both studied with Berriot, and his piano school was very focused on developing a singing and lyrical style, and Berriot looked to refine his students' tone production, and he also believed it was important for them to develop their improvisational skills, which will be important later on when he starts to compose. So eventually, Granados moves back to Barcelona in 1889, and he begins to perform more frequently around Spain with really good success. One of his critics said that Granados will be one of those good artists who always seek applause in pure art without flashiness and cheap concessions. The critic was especially impressed by the young man's good technical education as well as his delicate touch full of delicious smoothness. And around this time, Granados was mostly performing some of his own works, which included the Danzas Españolas and Valses Poéticos, but mostly romantic works by his contemporaries, which were what he liked the most, what he admired the most, what he liked to listen the most, and perform the most. So, as I said a little earlier about his education, this also applied to his education as a composer. He didn't really receive much formal training, and about the way that he composed, it was always grounded, first and foremost, in pianism, because that was the only instrument that he played. It was the instrument that he was educated on and that he was passionate about. And his compositional technique was always rooted in improvisation, which was probably pretty developed through his studies with Charles de Beriot in Paris. And he also focused mostly on like a very spontaneous and musical process over something that was like really labor intensive, and he had to sit down and think of all the theoretical aspects and things like that. And Granados himself thought that his best music came in the spur of the moment while he was on the piano. And even when I was like doing my reading for this lecture recital, one of the first sources I was looking at was the Grove article for him, and the writer even described his Goyescas, one of his piano pieces, as the finest written out improvisation. Because when I kind of chose this topic, I was already wondering why in most like musical, like academic or music history or theory settings, Granados isn't really talked about that much, even though I've enjoyed his music for a long time. And this kind of explains it a little bit, just because Granados himself wasn't really thinking about all of those specific things, then maybe a lot of other theorists or historians didn't think that his music was worth studying in that way, just because he didn't think of it that way. And he wasn't really considered an innovator during his time, which I don't think is a negative thing. I think what he's criticized on and what he's praised on is usually the same thing, which is like very simplistic, beautiful, lyrical, romantic melodies, and I think that's kind of what makes his music very charming and beautiful. About Granados and his musical language. So his musical language when composing is very much rooted in European traditions, but also blended with elements from traditional Spanish or Catalan folk music. And many of his rhythmic themes came from different European waltzes, dances like waltzes, mazurkas, and marches, as well as Spanish folk dances like the Jota, the Rapsodia Aragonesa, and the Capricho Español. And Goyescas was one of his most famous works, and it probably showed like the most, the widest variety of styles and kind of fusions. And this was a work that was kind of made up of six different piano sketches, like little miniatures, and they were inspired by paintings by Spanish painter Francisco Goya that Granados had seen when he went to the Museo del Prado in Paris, in Madrid, sorry. And he doesn't really specify which paintings, but it's just like a general inspiration from Goya. So after his death, Goyescas, Danzas Españolas, and his opera María del Carmen kind of became some of his most notable works, as well as like when he was alive. And he gained some pretty considerable fame within Barcelona, so where he was based, as well as other parts of Spain, but he didn't really gain much international recognition while he was alive. And he composed around 140 works, and most of them only began to be performed and recognized posthumously. So even now, like within the canon, we have like a very small sample of his works that are still performed and still known, but mostly kind of stayed in relative obscurity. So unfortunately, he drowned in 1916 when he was only 49 years old. So on the second leg of his journey back to Spain from when he was in the United States, his boat was struck by a German torpedo, and although the boat didn't actually sink, the impact threw many of the passengers into the Granados, and Granados was among those that were picked up by a life raft. But seeing his wife struggling, he made an attempt to go help her and try to save her, but they both drowned together. And this is, I think, pretty sad timing, just because he had just had his debut in the United States. He was premiering an adaptation of his piano work, Goyescas, that was turned into an opera. And it had really good reception from critics, but it's hard to know what his legacy would have been like now if he hadn't died so suddenly and so early in his career, because it seemed like he got good reception in the United States, which meant that he would have maybe gained more recognition outside of Spain and in other parts of the world. So, bad timing. So, about his legacy and his influence on music and the canon. So, unfortunately, we never really grouped Granados alongside the composers that he admired the most, which included like Beethoven, Schumann, Chopin, and Wagner. And however, he still holds a type of permanence in the European tradition of his time. And some of his works are definitely part of a canon, specifically in like the Spanish piano tradition, and then later for us in the classical guitar. And in part, we can attribute his secondary status that was given to him to the fact that he really didn't put out many symphonic works. He did have an orchestral work named Roma y Julieta that was lost, and another one named Dante, which was incomplete. So it makes it kind of difficult to assess him fairly in the world of, or like the gamma of orchestral works. And he does have a few, but none of them remained super popular, and none of them really come to mind very easily, which includes Suite sobre Cantos Gallegos, Marcha de los Vencidos, and Danza Gitana. And these were all works that I learned about in doing this research. Like, I didn't really know about them before. So it made me kind of think about why wasn't there a stronger symphonic tradition within Granados and within other Spanish composers in general. So there are a couple reasons why this could be. Firstly, there was never really a symphonic tradition in Spain, because there weren't many first-rate orchestras until the later part of the 19th century. And the public also had a much bigger interest in zarzuelas and operas, favoring them way over symphonic works. As well as the symphony was viewed as something that was way more German or French, definitely not Spanish, according to the public. And weirdly enough, people at this time in Spain viewed the symphony as a genre that was kind of already on its way out, like it was going to be passé very soon. So some writers praised his musical language because he kept his style very purely Spanish instead of following the French impressionist tradition. And Pedrell even said that he never got caught up in the caprice of exoticism or experimented with a tempting but corrupting French manner, which has corrupted so many. And on the other hand, some view him as having been less innovative and more conservative, therefore less significant than contemporaries like Albéniz and Falla in particular, who did succumb to that corrupting French manner. So when doing research in this, you get a lot of mixed reactions. You know, for the same reason, some people might love his style, some people might not really think it's interesting enough to really look at or study. But I have a couple of quotes kind of that like contrast those two ideas. And the first one is from the Grove article, and the writer writes, "Granados' foremost strength was undoubtedly his melodic gift, which can be best appreciated in his songs and piano works, though the latter are also his most variable achievements. His most obvious failing when deprived of a text was a poor sense of formal design, a deficiency accentuated in longer works by the vagueness of his modulations and his over-reliance on variation technique as a means of development. Granados made a significant contribution to the development of a national Spanish school, and though he is often considered more conservative than Albéniz or Falla, the degree to which native elements inform his music should not be underestimated, even if he must ultimately be reckoned a lesser figure." So to me, that sounds kind of like a backhanded compliment a little bit. But then you see a great appreciation of his music in a lot of other people. One of the first people that came to mind for me was the pianist Alicia de la Rocha, who's very known for like specializing in this type of music. and specifically Enrique Granados. And she wrote, "The first notes that I learned to play on the piano and that I presented in my first public recital were those of the Afternoon Bell from Sketches. As I matured musically and personally, I immersed myself in Granados' piano compositions, which form a major part of the foundation of modern Spanish music. My identification with his artistic temperament and his musical sensibility has profoundly influenced my career, and as often as I could, I have tried to familiarize the world with his music. The spirit of Granados is inextricably bound up with European Romanticism, with an adoration of Schumann, and with the soul of Spain's immemorial folkloric traditions, which the composers of his generation discovered and which he knew how to transform with his instinctive musical genius." So I feel like that sums up very well the appeal of his music and what makes his music kind of so different from the time and different from the trends that other composers were following. He definitely focused on kind of the core values and the core of what he really enjoyed, which was Romanticism and European traditions, while also blending with native elements from his country. About the piece that I'll be playing later in the lecture recital, the piece that I chose is Vasos Poéticos. So about the piece and about Granados' kind of relationship to the waltz. So Granados had shown an interest in the waltz, and he had the style appear in many of his previous works, like, for example, his stage work, Gaziel, centered musically around waltz themes that came up many times throughout the work, and they also play an important role in the characterization and the unification of the whole score. He also had a piece, Cartas de Amor, or Valses Íntimos, that he dedicated to his future bride, Amparo Gar, which was a collection of piano waltzes, and he had another collection named Valses Sentimentales. So it's thought that he composes around 1893 to 1894. There's not like a solid date on that. And he dedicated this piece to Joaquín Malats, who, if you remember, was one of his studio mates for when he studied with Joaquín Puyol. And he dedicated this piece to Malats, and Malats kind of has a bit of a connection to the classical guitar, specifically through his piece Serenada Española, which was originally transcribed for the guitar by Francisco Tárrega and later adapted by Andrés Segovia and Julian Bream. And the poetic in the title, so Poetic Waltzes, it's not really making direct reference to any specific piece of literature or a particular poem. And their poetic character is mostly just subjective, although Granados was known to love literary metaphors and romanticism in general. So a little bit about the waltz. This is a dance that is in triple meter, and it became one of the most popular dances of the 19th century. The name probably came from the German verb waltzen, and it also connects to the Latin verb vivere, which means to turn, or to rotate. And initially, this dance was considered like very scandalous and risque, because the partners had to dance with their bodies touching. And before this was like really unheard of. Before the waltz, all court dances were like rigid, stately, solemn. They were procession-based, and they were very controlled. They all had complicated moves and timings. So the waltz was kind of an introduction to the free-form dance. And the 3/4 waltz became overwhelmingly popular later in the 18th century, and it became kind of a standard across Europe. So eventually it strayed away from the belief that it was immoral and scandalous, and by the mid-19th century and early 20th century, the dance was brought and accepted into the United States. But during the First World War, the waltz became much more relaxed, and the dancers were much closer than they were before. But then the foxtrot pretty much ended the waltz craze, and by the end of the war, you know, the waltz was kind of out of style, especially in the United States. So about Granados and the guitar. Granados never actually played the guitar or composed for it, yet his pieces, like many of his pieces, have inserted themselves into the canon for our repertoire. Many of his works translate to the guitar pretty well because of their texture and their figurations in the accompanying lines, making them pretty idiomatic to the instrument. So in some of his like very nationalist piano music, you can really hear this because you can kind of hear a very clear idea that Granados was trying to show maybe a street guitarist or some kind of accompanist along with like a singer. singing line, which represented the singer. So it kind of makes it a little easier for that to be moved on to guitar. And because of the guitar centrality to Spanish folk music, evocations of it occur pretty frequently in Granados' nationalist piano pieces. But during his life, he must have been well acquainted with the guitar, specifically through his friendship with Catalan guitar virtuoso Miguel Llobet. Llobet transcribed a number of works during his lifetime, including some of Granados' La Maja de Goya and a few of his Danzas Españolas. Because I was trying to find who was the first person to begin like transcribing some of Granados' works, and although I didn't find like a straightforward answer, this seems like the most likely answer, just because they knew each other while they were both still alive, they were friends. So it makes sense that Llobet was probably the first person to move some of his pieces onto the guitar. But now, like, this is very normal to hear a lot of Granados' works through guitar. At least in my experience, with this piece specifically, the first time I heard this piece was a guitar transcription, and I just thought immediately that it sounded like it was made for the guitar, just because of some of the percussive elements, and it just sounds like those very classic Spanish traditions from that time. And as I said, now it's like very normal for this to happen. Some of his most known transcribers include Manuel Barreco, Shinichi Fukuda, Paolo Pegoraro, Chelia Trevicaya, and Andrew Zone, who's my professor here. He got very upset at me because when I had my jury for this lecture recital, I forgot to mention him. And so I lost some brownie points there. So I decided to include this one so I could hopefully make up some of those points. And yeah, part of this whole thing with my Valses Poéticos, a big part of the learning process has been very much about the transcription. My base transcription, I began with Paolo Pegoraro's, but immediately just starting to change a lot of stuff because you're trying to find a good compromise between the original piano, but also making sure that it sounds idiomatic on the guitar, because it's going to be almost impossible to take a piano piece and put every single note on the guitar and have it sound effortless and natural, which is very much the feel of this piece when played on the piano. It's kind of considered a more kind of intermediate level piece on the piano, but then on the guitar, a little more advanced just because you're taking a lot of stuff from the original piano and trying to put it on this instrument that has many technical limitations. So about the structure of this piece, which is a little peculiar, it is 8 waltzes, and it also includes an introduction at the beginning of the piece, and then the first waltz is repeated at the end. So each of these waltzes is kind of named after a general mood or feel, or it describes tempo of the waltz. And about the structure, which is one of the first things that I kind of thought of when starting this lecture, because Valses Poéticos is a multi-movement work, but it's not like a sonata or a suite, because like all the movements could be played by themselves as type of like short sketches, or they could be formed into various sets in theory, but it's kind of hard to find other pieces that follow this kind of like glued together series of dances type of approach. But here are some parallels that I was able to think of. So the first thing I thought about was just Baroque dance suites, like the ones by Bach and Handel and Rameau. But Valses is not really a type of suite, or it's not really inspired by Baroque suites. You're basically taking just one genre, which is the waltz or one dance, and then doing different iterations of the same dance in different kind of moods. There's also, I thought of Schumann just because Granados was such a big fan of Schumann, so I think of this Düsterliebe and Papillon specifically. So Schumann's Opus 2, Papillons, which means butterflies, it's a series of mostly waltzes, and this piece is supposed to paint a ballroom scene of a German romantic novel by Jean-Paul Richter. And there's a striking resemblance between the first waltz in Granados' work as well as Schumann's Papillons. And he kind of did the same thing as Schumann in Papillons, like they both have reprisals of the beginning of the work at the end of the work, but Granados' is like a full-on copy and paste of the first waltz put in at the end. And then Schumann's reprisal is a little bit more subtle, so it's kind of like a dreamlike callback. I also thought of just Brahms waltzes. His Opus 39 was a collection of 16 short waltzes. And also about Brahms, almost all the waltzes in this collection are in recapitulating binary form. And for each waltz, the first half moves to the dominant, the relative major, or a substitute key. And then for the second half, it begins with a developmental passage that leads back to the main theme and to the tonic. And a lot of this happens on each of Granada's waltzes as well. So then there's also like the waltz tradition of Chopin, his different waltzes and mazurkas. There's also Suarez de Vienne by Liszt, which is actually a transcription of different dance movements by Schubert. And this work is a collection of 9 waltz caprices, and the format is similar-ish to Granados' Valses Poéticos, just because like the short movements kind of put together into a cohesive larger work. There's also Ravel's Le Tango de Quiberon, although this one kind of is closer to Baroque dance suites. And then the most recent being Duke Ellington's The Queen's Suite, the Gutella Suite, and the Louis Suite, which are all of his jazz suites. So breaking down each movement, we start with the introduction, which is In Vivace Molto. So this one is in 2-4 time, so it's not really a waltz and it doesn't feel like it either, but it kind of comes in very energetically to kind of set off the mood and grab the listener's attention from the beginning for the rest of the piece. So this one's played at a very fast and lively tempo, and the texture is predominantly in 16th notes mixed in with some staccato 8th notes that act primarily as transitions between the different sections. So in this instruction, it's very percussive, and it's one of the movements that probably most mimics the guitar, in my opinion. There's lots of the block chords and the rolling chords, so it sounds like very idiomatic on the guitar versus on the piano. And then there's waltz number 1, Vals Melodico. This one is very beautiful and lyrical, and it's in A major, and it's accompanied by a repeating pattern of arpeggiated chords. So for the B section of the waltz, the key changes to the parallel minor, and then the melody moves onto the bass line before going back to the upper voice, and then back to the original key. And then to conclude, it repeats that initial A theme one more time. And I would like to play a little musical example of the piece I mentioned earlier, Schumann's Papillons, Opus 2, and then waltz number 1 by Granados from the Valses Poéticos. So this is probably why he accidentally self-quotes, like within his own compositions, and why he might have been accidentally quoting Schumann. I don't know if he was making a reference on purpose, like kind of a quote to like pay tribute to Schumann, who was like one of his favorite composers, or because he was kind of so loosey-goosey with his composition process, this was just something that he heard in a concert or that he was being playing, and he forgot that it wasn't something that he came up with, and he put it on the page. So moving on to the second waltz, this is Vals Appassionato. So in the score, it's marked Tempo de Vals Noble, so Tempo of Noble Waltz. And this one is very much rooted in like chromaticism when it comes to like the melodic line. So in the beginning, it has a very beautiful line going La, Te, Ti, Do. And then in the B section, kind of the same thing happens with that theme of chromaticism, except it's descending this time. It's still on the melodic line. And then on that second part of the B section, another chromatic line ascending again, but this time in the bass line. And this one is in F major, and it has very
noble but expressive character.
Waltz number three, Vals Lento. This was a D minor. It has a very slow and profound melody in that A section, and then the B section is very contrasting. It's in the parallel major, and it's a little more playful and rhythmic compared to that A section, which is very just sad and melancholy and deep. And this one sounds pretty similar to Schumann's Carnival Opus 9, the Allemande. So I will play that for you. It'll be the B section of the Granados and then the Schumann. The B section is in G minor and feels a lot more tumultuous, which is pretty contrasting to that first playful and easygoing section. Waltz number five, Vals Brillante, also marked Allegretto Elegante, so elegant. This one's also in B flat major. It's in a moderate tempo, which highlights that strong waltz feel, which is in 3-4. I feel like out of all of them, this one sounds like the most classic waltz, like the 1-2-3. So that moderate tempo definitely enhances the beautiful melody, and like waltzes 1 and 3, it modulates to the parallel minor in the B section, which is much more melancholy in contrast to the theme. Waltz number 6, Vals Sentimental. It's pretty big contrast from the waltz that came before it. This one's very melancholy and contemplative and feels more reflective. It's an F sharp minor, and I think it sounds pretty similar to this excerpt from Schubert's German Dances, Opus 33, number 6, which is that Liszt transcription, the Suarez de Vienne that I was talking about a second ago. So this musical example is of that B section in the Granados, and then the Schubert German Dances. Sorry, I will not play that example because I screen-recorded it on my computer and I thought it would just record the sound instead of everything else that was going on. But it's very similar to it. Take my word. Should have double-checked that. Okay, waltz number 7. This one is Vals Mariposa, or also marked as vivo, so alive, very fast. And this one is an A major and is one of the most technically showy waltzes in the collection, both in the original piano version as well as the guitar transcription. So what makes it the most challenging on the guitar is that it's constantly like fleeting through the fretboard, and you still have to keep it sounding very light and effortless, which makes sense. Vals Mariposa, Mariposa is butterfly, so it's kind of like they have very light and graceful wings, but they're fluttering very rapidly. And I thought that was kind of cool too, that you see Vals Mariposa and butterfly, and that also connects to the Schumann Papillons, but I don't know if I'm reaching with that. And then at the very end of the piece, waltz number 8, this one is Vals Ideali, and it's also marked as presto, A major once again. And this one is very fast-paced, very chromatic, mostly in accompaniment lines instead of the melody, like in some of the other waltzes that we discussed. So Vals Ideali, ideal waltz, this is kind of feels like a joke, considering that most of the waltz is in a 6-8 meter, so it feels much more like it's in 1-2 instead of 1-2-3, and there are only a few measures in that classic 3-4 waltz time. So I would say probably this one, along with the introduction, are the most idiomatic to the guitar, very percussive elements, and it makes me think that Granados had the Spanish guitar tradition in mind when he was writing similar to that previous shoot, waltz number 7, the challenge is to keep it, like, keep up with a rapid tempo while also keeping it sounding light, just because that's what it sounds on the original piano. So this one's kind of a juggling act. The most important thing to keep in mind is kind of Granados's ideas in this, so the beautiful melodic lines in this piece, which is probably what Granados himself kept most present during his compositional process. So it's kind of the same when you're trying to play his music, although it can be very challenging. You need to really just focus on what he wanted, which was melodicism and romanticism. So to conclude the piece, he does a reprisal of that first A major waltz. So instead of ending on a high and flashy note, like we just had with that little coda in the 8th waltz, Granados decides to bring it all back with the first waltz. So drawing a parallel to Schumann, one more time, the similar thing occurs in Papillons, as I just mentioned. So Schumann also had the reprisal, although it was less direct. This one is exactly the same thing you heard at the beginning. So it's hard to understand why Granados did this, just put the first waltz at the end again. I wasn't able to find a concrete reason when I was doing my research for this project, but my best guess is that he used this reprisal as a type of thread to connect everything together in the piece. Especially since his format is somewhat uncommon, it's kind of like a hodgepodge type of approach. He glued a bunch of waltzes together and called it a piece. The reprisal feels appropriate, and it feels like a reasonable way to conclude the work. And yeah, that's a rundown of the piece. That's my lecture recital. I'll be performing the actual piece now. So thank you for being here. I hope you enjoy my performance of this piece, which is really fun. It was really cool learning all about